one of the least known and certainly least celebrated facts about this beautiful river bottom hardwood forest and the old growth forest of these piney uplands here is this old growth forest wouldn't be here at all if it hadn't been for a decision that a man named Francis Biedler made nearly 100 years ago. After the Civil War had finished ruining the white pine and cedar forests of Michigan and the other Great Lakes states, and the timber industry turned its attention to the southeast here, and they looked at the wooded slopes of Appalachia and also down at these wonderful river bottom hardwood forests, and they started buying it up. Francis Biedler saw an opportunity to make a buck. He borrowed $1 million. I heard it was from the University of Chicago, which I never checked out. He came down here and he bought over 100,000 acres right here in South Carolina in the Congaree and Watery and Santee River drainages. He set up a timber company, the Santee River Cypress Lumber Company, and he set about to log the cypress, which were the big buck tree here. He could only hope to get out the ones that were easy to get to, which meant along the river and along the guts and the sloughs here in the swamp. It would have to be during the time of flood when it's taken out, because these are very big trees and very difficult to get out. The logging crews had a very tough time of it. They had to girdle the trees, kill them, let them dry out, drop them, and try to float them out down to a sawmill at Ferguson, now under the waters of Lake Marion. Proved to be a very marginally profitable, at best, sort of thing for Francis Biedler. And so by 1914, both the logging operation and the sawmill had been closed down. At that point, you would have expected them to sell out. After all, it was capital. It was capital that could be reinvested someplace else to make a good buck. But he did this unusual thing. He put it into a timber reserve. He wasn't a preservationist. He was a conservationist, which meant he intended to use this forest. But he saw that they were logging it out everywhere else. They were building reservoirs, building highways, cities were expanding, and they were logging, and these river bottom forests were disappearing. And he knew that someday these trees would be more valuable than they were at that time. Maybe not his son, maybe his grandsons and granddaughters would be harvesting it. So he put it into this timber reserve, and it just sat here while the rest of these forests disappeared. In the late 1960s, when the Biedler heirs, this would be the third generation of Biedlers, decided to resume logging here, it was a living dinosaur. There was nothing like it anywhere else. And so when I think about the forest and the chain of events that occurred to bring this into its presently preserved status, I think about that key decision that Biedler made. And I think that maybe we ought to give it a little more recognition here in the visitor center, and our exhibits, and certainly as we think back on the landmark events.